سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. أفمن شرح الله صدره للإسلام فهو على نور من ربه، صدق الله مولانا العظيم. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا ومولانا محمد وأصحابه وبارك وسلم صلاة وسلام عليك يا رسول الله صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم. Inshallah, today I'd like to finish the preface, the introduction of Imam Ghazali radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And yesterday we talked about the nature of the path and the nature of Ihsan. The path is very long and even very rough, with many obstacles, obstructions, and we are weak. Our lifespan is very short, and we do not have free time in order to prepare for Akhirah. Now, Imam Ghazali radiallahu ta'ala anhu begins by saying that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inspires someone to take this path, the suluk, the minhaj to Jannah, and this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned in the Quran, أَفَمَنْ شَرَحَ اللَّهُ صَدْرَهُ لِلْإِسْلَامِ فَهُوَ عَلَى نُورٍ مِّنْ رَبِّهِ. That when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala expands the chest of a person for Islam, فَهُوَ عَلَى نُورٍ مِّنْ رَبِّهِ, then he is upon the light from his Lord. He receives this guidance, this light from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وأشار إليه صاحب الشرع صلوات الله تعالى عليه وسلامه عليه فقال. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم has mentioned a hadith. إن النور إذا دخل القلب انفتح وانشرح. That when light enters the heart, it expands the heart and makes it spacious. It expands in شرح. فقيل يا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم هل لذلك من علامات يعرف بها. The companions asked, O Prophet of Allah, is there a sign that we can recognize that our hearts are filled with this light? What is the recognition? What is the way to recognize that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed in our hearts the light of Islam? And listen to this. Okay, these ahadith are like mirrors, always shows our reflection, true reflection. So what is the sign our heart is filled with this light? So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned three alama, three signs. Teen nishani. Number one, at-tajafa fi dar al-ghurur, to abstain from this deceiving world, to run away from this world. Wal-inabatu ila dar al-khulud, and to look forward for the hereafter, the world hereafter. والاستعداد للموت قبل نزولها, and to prepare for death before death comes. Three signs that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has filled our hearts with the light of Iman and Islam. Number one, not to be concerned whatsoever about this dunya. Number two, to prepare for Akhirah. And how can you do that? Number three, to prepare for death before death arrives. Now, Imam Ghazali radiallahu ta'ala alayhi wa says, the first step for Muslim is a thought of taking the path of worship. The niyyah will come. I mentioned this yesterday. First and foremost, what we need to do is make intention. Niyyah. That our intention is, inshallah, from today until our last breath, is to walk on this path of sirat. Now once he starts thinking about taking this path, he begins to contemplate upon his life. He begins to think about the favors of Allah, the ni'mat of Allah. Allah ki bari bari nishaniya. Allah ki ni'mat into Allah ta'ala uspar wali farmai. The ni'mat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for example, life. There's a great ni'mat of Allah just pondering over your life. is a means for you to turn back to Him. That you are nothing, and then you were created. You came to existence. Did you ask Allah, Ya Allah, create me? No, we didn't ask Allah. It is out of the grace of Allah, out of the mercy of Allah. Allah created us. We came to existence by the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The strength Allah has given us, wisdom, power of speech, etc. Start thinking about the bounties of Allah. Life and all the body limbs. Okay, the ni'mah of hearing, the ni'mah of seeing, the ni'mah of speaking, the ni'mah of holding, grasping, touching, walking. The ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us without me asking anything from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah gave it to us. Okay, I'm giving you these ni'mat. Utilize them, but at the same time show gratitude. Do you know there's a narration Imam Ghazali written in Ahya al-Ulum, talking about ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, talking about one blessing, eyesight. Do you know how valuable this is in the sight of Allah? We do not appreciate the ni'mah of basara, basir. Okay, that Allah is basir, has given us the reflection of its basara that we also see. On Yawm al-Qiyamah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will summon Imam who worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for 300 years. Teen so saal ki ibad lekar hazir hoga. Kitne saal ki ibad? 300 years. Okay, I'm talking about the past ummah. And he will say, Ya Allah, I want to be worthy of Jannah because of my worship. Enter me into Jannah due to my worship. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, you've not even repaid one of my ni'mah. The house is Ya Allah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala pays 300 years. Let's see, we're talking about our lifespan, 60 years, 45 years from baligh until we pass away, average. 45, 50 years of worship we have. Yeah, 300 years of worship we place on one side of the scale. And one eye, the ni'mah of eye, will be placed on the other side of the scale. The ni'mah of the eye will outweigh the 300 years of worship. Allah will say, you may well repay one ni'mah because of this, go to Jannah. Say, Ya Allah, no. Place me and enter me into Jannah out of your rahmah, out of your grace. So he will eventually enter Jannah out of mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we cannot repay the bounties of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So start pondering upon, unfortunately, in this age, we have forgotten this concept of pondering, meditation. Okay. That Allah has blessed me so many blessings. Start pondering upon yourselves. You know, you've got people working in pharmacy, okay, you've got dentists, optometry. Understand that they study years to study one single ni'mah, one ni'mah. Okay, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us so many blessings. وَإِن شَكَرْتُمْ لَزِيدَنَكُمْ وَإِن تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةُ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا. Allah says, if you were to start counting the blessings of Allah, لَا تُحْصُوهَا, you are not able to count the blessings of Allah. Every single breath is a blessing of Allah. Every single heartbeat is a blessing of Allah. Every single step we take is a blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Oxygen we're taking, carbon dioxide take out. Okay, there's no machine that changes oxygen to carbon dioxide. It happens naturally. Allah has created a system, internal system, that everything functions perfectly. And yet we do not believe Him. And yet we do not have few moments in our day, 5 times a day, to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he also realized that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has provided a means of protection. Look at the way Allah has created our body, the immune system. Okay, look at how many times we blink in a day. Have you ever thanked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah has given us the ability to blink? Imagine if you cannot blink. Yeah. Dust and other things will start entering the eye. Your eye will become dry, become infected. Okay, even the liquid in the eye has got antibacterial elements. So, and this is the blessing of Allah, you blink and yet we do not. And then the eyelash, look at eyelash. Every you start pondering upon your own creation, or fi anfusikum afala taqun, Allah says, there are signs that Allah exists. Look at yourself. Wa fi anfusikum. Look at yourself, look at your body, how it functions. Afala taqun. Do you understand that Allah exists? So through the verse of the Quran, in the light of the Quran, Imam Ghazali says, the first and foremost, take some time out. Start pondering upon the blessings of Allah. Because this will initiate you to start walking a path to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Start appreciating bounties of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then this thought will trigger him to believe that, of course, there must be a creator. There must be a creator. All these blessings. These atheists, these scientists, they say we came to existence with no prior existence. No one created us. After Big Bang Theory, okay, it happened through DNA, the iron came together, and then hydrogen, and all these elements came together, and the first element of molecule was created, and a few molecules, insects came to, or bacteria was created through bacteria, insects, and upper animals, and then reptiles, and then apes, and then humans. Okay, if you just think about that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created us, actually that means we are the best creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yeah? And then, once we understand, first, so step number one, start calling upon the ni'mah of Allah. Okay, internal and out and out. Look at the wind, the trees, the fruits, the birds, the sun, the clouds, the stars, the sun, the moon. All, everything. Do you know the ulama, the sufi, they mentioned everything. Everything has been created to serve human beings. Okay, look at the sun, if you do science, biology. Okay, photosynthesis. The importance of sun, yeah, and moon, and the birds, and they have the ecosystem. Okay, the food chain we have. Everything is to serve human beings, and human beings have been created to serve Allah. Everything has been created. Okay, we sacrifice chicken. We eat animals, we eat grass, we eat fruits and veg. Everything has been created for us, and we have been created. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ جِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. Only to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So now the thought will come. And do you know, I want to mention at this point, one of the greatest challenges the ulama, the people of who work in the field of religion have, is many, many youth. Boys and girls, they come into ulama. I'm talking through experience. Many text messages that I receive. There are many people, many youngsters who go to university who are not attached to masajid, to religious circles. And now they fall into the top of shayateen waswasa. They're now doubting. They have shak in the existence of Allah. So many years we have challenges about so many youth into drugs and alcohol and gambling, addiction. It's in our society. Okay, we need to tackle these problems. But the greatest problem now, okay, we receive the ulama, are receiving the question, is that youngsters who are studying universities, philosophy, okay, and other sciences in university, they are attached to these groups, they are doubting the existence of Allah. And why is that? It's because we have stopped thinking. Okay, we do not think for ourselves. Our mind, Allah has given us aqal to contemplate in existence. Look at the beautiful sky at night. Look at the crescent moon and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala yas'alunaka anil ahilla. Allah, you know, the Prophet asks about this hilal. Qul hiya mawaqit lin nas. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the beautiful moon, the sun, the stars, the cloud. Yeah. All these are the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You just need to ponder upon the creation of Allah. That's the first step. And this is from the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that even the Prophet was before receiving wahi, before receiving Qur'an, where did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam go? He would go to the cave of Hira. He would spend days and nights contemplating on the creation of Allah. What has happened to insan? That they are disbelieving in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They have started worshipping idols. As Allah is wahid, is ahad. For so many, at the age of 38 until the age of 40, for 2 or 3 years before receiving wahi, the Prophet ﷺ would spend days and nights pondering upon the creation of Allah, which we neglect. And those who are set in the i'tikaf, it's a golden opportunity, 10 days of i'tikaf, you shun away from this dunya, you're in the month of Ramadan, you're in the masjid, only be concerned about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's a golden opportunity to open these closed doors of wisdom and knowledge. So you need to start pondering upon everything. When you raise your hand, do you know how many billions of senses we have? What do you call it in our brains? Yes? These nerve cells are working together so that we function our body. Is this amazing? Is this amazing? SubhanAllah. So then, what will happen? Then we will understand Allah has created us, Allah exists, the Creator exists. Now, what does Allah want us from us? He wants us to worship Him. Now, how do you worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the Prophet alayhi wa sallam. And how do you know the prophets are haq? They are true. They are true messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They show miracles, mu'jiza. And the greatest miracle we have, which we can read, which we can hold, which we can touch, is the Holy Quran. And then these prophets alayhi wa sallam, they came to their respectful ummah and nations and said, they informed them about the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah is ala kulli shayin qadeer, Allah is all powerful, and He does whatever He wills. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded us to undertake certain tasks and command us to abstain from certain things, the fara'id and the haram. And then the second step will take over, and that is once we start contemplating upon our life, we look at other people, they don't live forever. So one day, once this thought comes into our head, in our minds, in our heart, that we're not going to live in this dunya forever, what will happen? Imam Ghazali says, we're going to feel qalaq, worried, anxious. Okay, oh no, I need to leave this world. I need to prepare for akhirah. I need to face Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there is going to be hisab. Yes, of every single ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this feeling will be created in his heart. Qalaq, worry, anxious. And this fear, this anxious, this worry will take him out of heedlessness, neglect, laziness. Do you know what's so laid back? Okay, we pray namaz whenever we want to, we give zakat if we want to, we'll fast if we want to, we'll abstain from haram whenever we feel like to.
Yes.
If there's someone in front of a family member, we'll abstain from haram. If they want, with friends, okay, we stop doing haram. This is ghafla. This is ghafla. اقترب للناس حسابهم وهم في غفلة معرضون. Allah says, you know, beautiful, اقترب للناس حسابهم. Insan, hisab, qareeb hai, the hisab account we have to give to Allah is very close. But what is the same insan? في غفلة. They are in heedlessness. They are in غفلة. They don't want to think about akhirah. Muslims have forgotten. Forget the non-Muslims. We Muslims have forgotten about akhirah. We rarely think about akhirah. We rarely think about the one day Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will tell us, ya fulan fulan, stand, oh son, oh so-and-so, the son of so-and-so, stand. We will be standing in front of everyone and we have to read our hisab kitab. Or we have to read our books. Iqra kitab. Read your book. We have forgotten all these things. And this is why people start doubting the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then what will happen? Now this will prompt him to go in search for salvation. How can I save myself? How can I save my iman? How can I start worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So Imam Ghazali radiallahu then says, now the first person will start stepping into the first valley. First aqaba, the aqaba of knowledge. The first valley, the first step, the first valley he's gonna enter is, he will enter into the steep valley of knowledge, of ilm. Imam Ghazali radiallahu ta'ala then says, it is important for us to have knowledge two things. Our inner and outer knowledge. Okay, our worship. So, we're going to talk about it, inshallah, from tomorrow. Okay, how to purify yourself properly. How to do wudu, how to do ghusl. Like what things will break your wudu, what things will break your ghusl. How to pray your salah properly. Okay, how do you read the Quran properly? All these are outer aspects of worship, ibadah. And then we have the inner aspect of worship, sincerity, ikhlas, for the sake of Allah, tawakkul, khawf ilahi, and hub ilahi, all these elements which we need to start learning. And then he says, for this, the people, ourselves, we need to go to ulama, who will teach us both sciences, the outer sciences and the inner sciences. Okay, don't learn from Google. Or from some TV channel which you shouldn't be watching anyway. We have ulama, ulama rabbaniyin, ulama of Ahlul Sunnah Jama'ah, that they will show you the right path. Because they were taught by their teachers, who were taught by their teachers, who were taught by their teachers, who were taught by Sahaba Ikram, who were taught by the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and was taught Ar-Rahman Allam Al-Quran by Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. And do you know the beauty of our ulama Ahlul Sunnah Jama'ah? When you sit in the majlis, this is what the Sufi Kiram we have mentioned. That when you go to these great ulama Kiram who devoted their lives to disseminate knowledge, the beauty of Islam, they are exhaling the air which they inhale from their teachers. Their teachers inhale the air exhaled by their teachers. Goes back to the companions who inhale the air exhaled by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Nat al-Mi'raj, the Prophet inhaled the air from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is it. Okay, this is a beautiful thing of the tradition of Islam. Okay, so don't just seek knowledge from any person. You need to be very careful. And then, once a person seeks this knowledge, he will be certain Allah exists, and he will start worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But then once you start worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you remember one thing. You start remembering his past life. You start remembering the sins he committed, the major and minor sins, the outer and inner sins, the rights which he violated, the rights of Allah, and the rights of the huquq al-ibadah, of other people, other creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He will start thinking about the sins he committed. I'm standing in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the same time. I'm carrying the burden of sins. Now we will step into the second valley. And the second valley is Aqabat Tawbah, the valley of repentance. Okay, very important topic, inshallah. We're going to touch upon it, inshallah, in the following days. Now he's gone through the valley of knowledge, the valley of Tawbah. Now you're going to start worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then at this moment, you will face four great obstacles that will try and stop him from worship. Number one, dunya. The world. Whatever is in it. Yeah? Number two, the people themselves. Your friends, your family, you've got children, you've got wives. You've got children, you've got other family members to look after. Huh? And then you have number three, your own nafs. You have your ego. Sometimes it's tiring too long. The shaitan is doctor away. But what makes us tired is the nafs. Okay. The shaitan is not there to divert attention. He's doctor away. But what makes you tired of the army? Some people, subhanAllah, they're way outside and when it's Salatul Witr, they come inside. It's the nafs, it's the ego. It happens. And then we have number four, shaitan lahim. Okay, you have shaitan with us, in our lives. So how do you tackle this? Number one, if it's a world, renounce the world. Okay, and live on bare minimum. It's a great challenge. It's a great challenge. People, if people around you, go in seclusion. Okay, unfortunately nowadays, it's a small world. Yeah, it's, you know, how many WhatsApp groups we are in? 20, 25, assalamu alaikum, and 1,000 people, walaikum salam, this is really walaikum salam all day long. Okay, how are you? Alhamdulillah, 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 alhamdulillah. Yeah? So just wasting a lot of time. People, nonsense. Okay, how many people are necessarily, they don't need to be on social media, but they are. Okay, they want to follow this football player, this person, that person, and then, you know, you glue to the dunya, it's so much information of dunya. You just glue to it. Addiction is addiction nowadays. This is an addiction nowadays. Before, okay, it's a way of the shayateen. So how to distract people? This is one of the obstacles. I mean, this is one of the greatest obstacles. In the month of Ramadan, just try to minimize it. You can try to go off, switch off the mobile, can you can, or at least, you know, switch off your social media. Be off it. There's no point. This is month of Ramadan to rectify yourself. A time to go back to Allah Subhanahu. Don't waste your time on these things. Okay, you know, so many people, they WhatsApp this message and this video and that video. Where do you get the time to watch all that? Switch it off. At least have a tasbih in your hand. Okay, make a habit, make an aim. The first week, every single day, I'm going to say La ilaha illallah 1,000 times a day. Istighfar 1,000 times a day. Dushit 1,000 times a day. Week after 2,000 times. Week after 3,000 times. Last week 4,000 times. Make an aim. You should have an aim every single day. Not that, okay, month of Ramadan, so roze rakh liya, okay, bhookh lagi hai, pyaas lagi hai, namaz padh liya, masjid mein aana, iftari kar liya. This is how we're going to spend the day of Ramadan. Make it something special for yourselves. Okay, make an aim. Okay, this year I'm going to try and finish at least one Quran. Some brothers can't even manage that. Okay, if you can't, it doesn't matter, but at least try and do something. And then if you can read more, read the translation. Is try and do something more in the month of Ramadan. The self, which I'm going to talk about later on. And then you say the shaitan trying to resist his force. And you know all these things, Allah, Imam Ghazali mentioned in his book in very detail. How to tackle these things. This is the only introduction, preface of his book. And then he says about the nafs. He says, nafs is the most severe one. The most difficult one to conquer, to control is the nafs. It's because world, you can shun the world. Okay, you can stay away, you can close the doors away from the people. Okay, shaitan, a'udhu billahi minash shaitan rajim, do da'u tasmiya, and you know, you do wada'i, you run away. But nafs will be with you throughout your life. You cannot kill your nafs, remember this. You cannot kill your nafs. But you can tame your nafs, you can control your nafs. And nafs is very important for you later on as you go into worship. Because nafs will help you to do more good deeds. Do you know how we show cow to a donkey? You know how they train the donkeys. They have a stick and then there's a cow dangling on in front of the stick. And then the donkey tries to go for the cow and then the owner starts moving the cow further. And the donkey will reach a destination without realizing that it walked hundreds of miles, tens of miles, because of that cow. Nafs the same thing, we need to show the dangling carrot. That's the Jannah. Okay? For us, for awliya, they don't care about Jannah. For us, the palace of Jannah. That if you were to pray two rakat, if you pray Salatul Awabin, after Salatul Maghrib, Allah will build for you a palace. The Prophet mentioned these rewards for us because of our nafs. Imam Ghazali mentioned that for us, beginners, we always concerned about reward. If I was to pay namaz, what reward would I get? If I do fast, what will I get? If I give zakat, what is the reward? If I go hajj, what is the reward? If I pay Quran, what is the reward? It's always about reward. Yes? But Fajr nahi padhenge, Isha nahi padhenge, Maghrib tak chhut gayi, okay, they were aware. Do rakat nafal to padhenge mujhe. After pay the 2 rakat nafal, what is the reward? Is Allah is going to increase your life. Allah's other two rakats, Allah will increase your sustenance. Other 2 rakats, Allah will protect you from calamity. But the greatest calamity was that you do not pray Salatul Fajr. If you don't pray namaz, your lifespan will decrease, your risk will decrease, and you will be facing calamities in this dunya, in the grave, in the akhirah. So this is how the gambling car in front of you. Huh? So this is the valley of Awai, or the obstacles. So he says, nafs is very, very difficult to control. Inshallah, we stop here. And Imam Ghazali, radiallahu ta'ala, he goes to the other valley, inshallah, which we we'll talk about in the following days, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us a tawfiq. Just to conclude, we said first valley is a valley of knowledge. The outer knowledge and the inner sciences we learn. Second step is sincere tawbah. We're going to learn about tawbah. Okay, the four different types of tawbah we need to do. The huququllah, two types. Huququl-ibah, two types. And then we had the path of the valley of obstacles, the four. Which ones? Dunya, people inside, nafs and shaitan. Okay, and we learned briefly how to tackle these. Inshallah, tomorrow we'll talk about more about these valleys. Inshallah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all the tawfiq, inshallah. اللهم صل على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا ومولانا محمد معدن الجود والكرم وآله وصحبه وبارك وسلم. اللهم ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم. اللهم افتح علينا حكمتك وانشر علينا رحمتك يا ذا الجلال والإكرام. اللهم اغفر وارحم وأنت خير الراحمين. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا ومولانا محمد وأصحابه وبارك وسلم. بفضل سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله.